afternoon, everybody. We'll be starting the free paper session on vitreoretinal diseases and retina. And our first speaker would be. But before we start, we sincerely apologize for a little bit of delay because these sessions are overlapping and a little bit delay has to be expected. So we start with the first speaker. And he will be speaking on real-world outcomes in surgical management and significant submacular hemorrhages.
Very good afternoon, everybody. I don't have any finance and interest regarding this subject discussed in this paper. So you know the most important etiologies for submacular hemorrhage are neovascular AMD, PCV, ruptured macroaneurysm stroma. The management depends on the duration of the
surgery. One second. Timer
can we have the timer properly, sir? Okay.
So size of the hematoma, it can be small, medium, or massive according to the survey of ophthalmology. And TP-assisted subretinal blood removal was described by the Payman et al. For more significant submacular hemorrhage, more than 4 degrees diameter, the lot of combinations are available like intravitreal TPA, intracollular gas combination, vitrectomy along with subretinal TPA, intravitreal TPA, or subretinal TPA plus ranibizumab. Submacular surgery by creating small retinotomy by or temporal retinectomy along with RP choroid patch graft transplantation or macular translocation are the available treatment modalities. So in the present study, we tried to retrospectively analyze all the cases of significant submacular hemorrhage with more than 4 degrees diameter in size and tried to evaluate the real world anatomical outcomes, functional recovery, and the complications after the surgical management. It was methods. It was a retrospective study which included all consecutive 75 cases of significant submacular hemorrhage of more than 4 degrees diameter were treated by vitrectomy in last 7 years in group A, less than 4 weeks duration, confined to the macula or extending inferiorly, where vitrectomy with subretinal TP injection was given, followed by cocktail of subretinal anti-VEGF along with subretinal AR injection was given, and at the end of surgery, fluid exchange followed by gas tamponade was done. So in group B, 4 to 8 weeks duration extending beyond macula, where vitrectomy with subretinal TPA injection was given for the clot lysis, more extensive, more submacular hemorrhage. So here, after in group B1, we removed subretinal blood by creating small retinotomy. In group B2, we did a temporal retinectomy and removal of the blood, and along with fluid exchange in group B1, followed by laser, and group B2 with the help of PFC retina settlement done, followed by laser along with siliconal injection was given, done, performed. And group C, more than 8 weeks duration, extending beyond macula, more extensive was vitrectomy with submacular hemorrhage removal by creating temporal retinectomy, then removal of the submacular blood along with the CNVM, and RP was quite compromised in this case. She injected PFCL to keep the retinal flap away from the working site. Then choose a relatively healthy looking area of RP choroid part to take the graft under the central slide under the PFCL bimanually with the help of 2 forceps. The choroid graft has been, full thickness RP choroid graft has been transferred to the proposed site of the fovea, and graft alignment done, then followed by removal of the PFCL, and then then settlement of the retina by injecting PFCL anterior to the retina, followed by fluid exchange, followed by laser and silicon and PFCL exchange was done. We postoperatively did BCV, ultra wide field fundus photography, optos, OCT, ultrasonography. Complications were analyzed. We included all cases of significant submacular hemorrhage of more than 4 degrees diameter in size, excluding cases with this pallor. Postoperatively, visual improvement was quite significant in all the three groups. In group A, p-value was less than 0.001. In group 2, in both retinotomy and retinotomy group, the visual improvement was quite significant. P-value was 0.016. In group C also, visual improvement was quite significant. P-value was less than 0.001. So these are the real-world complications in group A in our study. Recurrent submacular hemorrhage, vitreous hemorrhage, hyphema and macular formation was quite high, and with the other complications in group B, where recurrent submacular hemorrhage, vitreous hyphema and epiretinal membrane was quite high. Group C, hypotony followed by retinal detachment was more complicated. These are a few examples of complications in group A, right, decadent submacular hemorrhage, which occurred after 14 weeks of intervention, and postoperative macular hole formation, which was ultimately closed after doing resurgery with inverted flap technique. In group B, epididymal membrane was the complication. We removed the ARM along with silicone removal. In hyphema, we faced in group B also, and two cases with corneal blood staining. Postoperative complications in group C, recurrent RDs, excessive subretinal scarring. In one case, choroidal hemorrhage occurred at the base of the RP choroid graft. The logistic algorithm of treating submacular hemorrhage is still lacking. Preferred technique often determined by the extent, duration, as well as the surgeon's preference. Photoreceptors are mainly affected by submacular hemorrhage, which are relatively healthy till 2 to 4 weeks of duration. So non-linear technique, it is beneficial with vitrectomy and cocktail injection till 4 weeks. Beyond 4 weeks, extending beyond macula, more extensive. So we have to remove the blood by injecting subretinal TPA, trotolysis, to prevent further permanent damage of the photoreceptor as well as the RP selectivity. And if it is more than 8 weeks, there is extensive compromisation of the RP, so we have to do the graft transplantation along with CNVM removal. When we compared our complication with the other studies, so macrol, all our complications are comparable except the macrol was more in our study. Group B complications also comparable to the other studies, and group C complications are also comparable, except in group B, there was a little bit less recurrence of submacular hemorrhage and no incidence of glaucoma was noted. And so surgical intervention in significant submacular hemorrhage, more than 4 weeks diameter, usually rewarding, though occasional complications may arise. Early and frequent follow-up are necessary. Thank you.
Very nice presentation, Dr. Bodal.
Yes.
We know that sometimes subretinal TPA and even intravitreal TPA is associated with retinal break formation,
yes,
probably due to the action of the drug itself. Did you come across any of these cases?
Retinal break formation, subretinal TPA, initially subretinal TPA, I used to give in my first 25 cases. I was not that much of like, it was inside the macular vascular arcade I have given. At that time, in three of my out of five cases, we faced macular IOT and macular formation. But after that, we modified our treatment. We went as far as to the fovea to prevent the secondary macular formation. In postoperatively, we did resurgery with the inverted flap technique. All the holes were finally closed. So that is also a take home, like when you are injecting subretinal TPA along with intravitreal subretinal anti-VEGF and here, there is tremendous overload, subretinal overload. So that can cause atrophying macular hole. So if you, in one of my case, I did just small fluid reduction last in the morning, ASR symposium I was showing, I did just little bit of drainage from the macular hole, and I was fortunate enough the macular was closed postoperatively. But in other cases, what I faced, that is macular hole secondary in postoperative period, so I have to do the secondary, this inverted flap technique as a second surgery.
So in your study, what was the commonest cause of the submacular hemorrhage?
It is either neovascular AMD or PCB, mostly neovascular AMD.
Good. Yes. Next speaker.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Puran.
Next paper would be long-term retrospective comparative study of ranibizumab with aflibastine in CMV in patients with subretinal neovascular membranes. You're coming? The second one is absent?
Ms. Kanchan Singh, absent?
Okay, third paper would be comparing morphological changes in OCT angio of aflibastine versus bevacizumab in neovascular ARMD.
In neovascular ARMD, abnormal blood vessels originate from the choroid and extend beneath the Bruch's membrane and the RP or the subretinal space. The two most commonly used anti-VEGF agents are aflibercept, which is a recombinant fusion protein that binds all the isoforms of VEGF-A and VEGF-B And the other very commonly used anti-VEGF is bevacizumab, which is a full-length monoclonal antibody which targets all the isoforms of VEGF-A. Spade has suggested two hypotheses which are responsible for the progression of neovascular ERMD. One is angiogenesis, where there's a formation of new capillaries sprouting from the vascular endothelium to form new vessels. This is stimulated by VEGF, and this is VEGF dependent. And the later stage is arteriogenesis, where there's remodeling of the collateral vessels into large functional vessels in response to the high flow of blood in the vascular circuit. This is independent of VEGF, and this does not get affected by any type of anti-VEGF agent. So the main purpose of this study is to evaluate the morphological changes on OCT angiography following intravitreal injection of aflibercept versus bevacizumab in neovascular ERMD. This is the retrospective analysis of 20 eyes. 9 eyes underwent treatment with aflibercept and 11 eyes underwent treatment with bevacizumab. The inclusion criteria to choose the cases was intraretinal fluid or subretinal fluid on SD-OCT and a neovascular membrane seen on OCT angiography, and all the images were evaluated, one pre-injection baseline and at 3, 6 and 12 months up after the first injection. The main two lesion characteristics which were studied were the early active lesion, which starts as numerous tiny capillaries which branch from the larger vessels and eventually form peripheral arcades. This is the stage of angiogenesis. And then there is the chronic late phase where due to the pressure of blood, there is the formation of mature trunk vessels and anastomotic loops. So in both these groups, the age and OCT thickness was almost the same. Only the main difference was that the patients in the bevacizumab group had a much worse baseline pre-injection vision. This is a heat map comparing the morphological changes in both the groups over 12 months. Here you can see that in the pre-injection phase, most of the eyes had capillary branches and peripheral arcades in both the groups. However, at 3 months post-injection, you can see that the stage of angiogenesis, which is the capillary branches, showed a much higher rate of regression as compared to the patients who were treated with bevacizumab. And you can see at 6 months post-injection that the changes of the chronic neovascular membrane, which is the mature trunk vessels and anastomotic loops, were seen in a much higher percentage in patients in the bevacizumab group, and this findings were also seen at 12 months after follow-up. So in patients who undergo treatment with bevacizumab, the probability of finding chronic neovascular changes like anastomotic loops and trunk vessels is much higher, both 6 and 12 months after injection in the patients who are treated with bevacizumab. And even the odds of having trunk vessels is much higher in patients who undergo bevacizumab treatment. These findings correspond with Spade's hypothesis that anti-VEGF agents block the sprouting of new vessels and reduce vascular leakage. And our study showed that patients who were treated with aflibercept showed a much better blocking of the stage of angiogenesis. Also, the increase in blood flow in the vascular channels is the main stimulus for creating arteriogenesis, and we found that aflibercept was able to prevent arteriogenesis better. Even though there is a regression of the peripheral tufts, the persistence of central trunk vessels and anastomotic loops will still persist and continue in spite of anti-VEGF treatment. And this incidence was lower. And so we found that aflibercept is able to better regress the new vessels in angiogenesis and thus prevent the arteriogenesis. Thank you.
Thank you, Rahul, for presenting your data. What made you choose the two extremes, aflibercept on one side and bevacizumab on the other?
This is from our old data. So we had many patients who have been treated with bevacizumab and a certain group which aflibercept. And actually, we didn't have many with this thing, ranibizumab, which is the only other drug which we could have compared. And these are two completely different pathways, because one is a monoclonal antibody and the other one is a fusion protein. So this is just to compare which pathway can prevent arteriogenesis better. Because once a patient goes into arteriogenesis, frankly, there is no kind of reversal possible.
And did you find a difference between type 1 and type 2 CNVM?
No, actually, most of my patients were in type 1 only. Most were of the sub-RP.
Good. Next paper, I think Dr. Sriram has not come. Pardon? No, you cannot change.
He is the co-author.
Okay, go ahead.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be speaking on post-COVID-19.
Just a minute. Madam has to ask some.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be speaking on post-COVID-19 vitreoretinal complications consecutive case series. Few studies describe the retinal manifestations following COVID-19 patients recently. The manifestations may vary according to the geographical location, ethnicity, severity of disease, nature of treatment received, vaccination status, and various other factors, and are continuously evolving with time. Our purpose was to describe the post-COVID-19 VR manifestations from a multi-specialty tertiary hospital in North India. A retrospective chart review including all consecutive cases with VR manifestations following RT-PCR confirmed COVID-19 disease from July 20 to June 29 were included. So I'll be describing the results in the sequential photograph. So our first case was a bilateral aspergillus endogenous endophthalmitis. So he was a 55-year-old male who presented with severe COVID pneumonia and also turned into steroid-induced diabetes mellitus. He had a history of pulmonary tuberculosis for which he received ATT 15 years back. Best corrected visual acuity at presentation was hand movement in right eye and 6x9 in the left eye. Systemic consult revealed bilateral brain tuberculoma and a cavitary lung lesion. In the photograph, we can see the right eye had hypopyon and dense vitreous exudates, and the left eye had focal nasal chorioretinal infiltrate with myelinated nerve fiber and mid-peripheral retinal infiltrates. So the both eye underwent initial intravitreal injections and right eye underwent partial and a vitrectomy. The vitreous tap revealed septate hypoaspergillus positive. Left eye also underwent multiple intravitreal injections, following which we can see gradual organization of the nasal exudates. The final best corrected visual acuity improved to counting finger 1 foot in the right eye and 6x9 in left eye, and inflammation resolved in both eyes. But second case was also a both eye aspergillus endogenous endophthalmitis. She was a 63-year-old female, suffered from moderate COVID and also converted into steroid-induced diabetes mellitus. The best corrected visual acuity was 6x36 in the right eye and hand movement in the left eye. So we can see there was dense vitreous exudates in the both eye, and the systemic consult revealed right hydronephrosis. Both eye received multiple intravitreal injections, followed by both eye parts plana vitrectomy was done. Left eye additionally underwent silicone oil tamponade, and the vitreous tap was positive for aspergillus. She also had systemic voriconazole, but hallucination developed and we shifted her to oral itraconazole. Finally, the vision and inflammation resolved in both eye. Vision also improved. Third case was unilateral presumed fungal endogenous endophthalmitis. She was a 48-year-old female, mild COVID, no prior comorbidities. Best corrected visual acuity was finger counting and 6x6. We can see intraoperatively multiple vitreous membranes and subfoveal abscess, following which there was a formation of subretinal hemorrhage, although inflammation got resolved in the right eye. So case four was bilateral presumed fungal retinitis. She was a 45-year female, suffered severe COVID pneumonia, received IV steroids and a history of prolonged ICU stay. HRCT chest revealed post-COVID sequelae with fungal infection. Bronchoalveolar lavage was positive for septate IP. She also underwent multiple intravitreal injections, although no organisms could be isolated from vitreous biopsy. Fifth case was a 26-year-old lady. She suffered from mild COVID, presented with right eye acute paracentral scotoma and tumbling of letters. Examination revealed right eye paracentral grayish white opacity, and the OCT revealed a hyperreflective placoid lesion at the junction of outer nuclear and outer plexiform layer, suggestive of acute macular neuroretinopathy. OCP was discontinued, and she was assured lesion resolved gradually in 6 weeks. Sixth case was a 32-year-old lady. She had a mild COVID 4 weeks back, presented with sudden diminution of vision. Best corrected visual acuity was hand movement in left eye. Examination revealed pale disc, sclerosed vessel, and multiple four-quadrant retinal hemorrhage. OCT from outside also had inner retinal layer hyperreflectivity, and FFA was also outside done. It was suggestive of combined vascular occlusion. But seventh case was a female, 24 years. She had mild COVID 6 weeks back. She was also a known case of autoimmune thyroiditis, presented with left eye sudden metamorphosis, presented with 6x12 visual acuity, fundus revealed left eye multifocal neurosensory detachment. OCT also revealed multiple pockets. Angio revealed late pulling of dyes and late leakage. She was differential diagnosis of APM, PPE, unilateral VKH and posterior scleritis was kept. She was assured an oral corticosteroid was given, and the lesion resolved in 6 feet with improvement of best corrected visual acuity. This is in nutshell about all of the cases. So we present a diverse spectrum of VR manifestations following COVID-19 disease or sequelae or treatment. High index of suspicion for patients receiving prolonged systemic corticosteroids following COVID-19 disease is required. Bedside fundus evaluation is needed for high-risk patients. Timely systemic and intravitreal antimicrobial agents plus minus PPV is essential for favorable structural outcome in endogenous endophthalmitis patients. Vigilance is required for uncommon but possible drug-induced side effects like voriconazole-induced transient hallucination. Fundus of post-COVID patients with mild visual impairment should also be evaluated for possible uncommon complications like acute macular neuroretinopathy and exudative maculopathy. Meticulous history, detailed systemic evaluation, appropriate investigations, and a prompt multidisciplinary holistic approach are important for achieving a favorable outcome. Thank you.
How do you quantify that your complications were COVID-19 induced or they were steroid-induced?
Sir, all of these cases are RT-PCR proved COVID within 3 months of RT-PCR COVID. So they have been investigated for other complications, other comorbidities and these things also. So we presume, especially for endogenous endophthalmitis patients, these are just post-COVID, majority of were on steroids. And for other acute macular neuroretinopathy, they also did not have any other history other than...
Okay, any case of central retinal artery occlusion, central venous occlusion?
One patient of combined vascular occlusion, although I saw other patients post-vaccine, but these are only for post-COVID, not post-vaccine.
Okay, wonderful.
I had a small question. Your first case actually had a brain tubercular involvement. How did you differentiate
Yes, sir. So that patient had brain tuberculoma as well as bilateral lung cavitary lesion. So diagnostic dilemma was whether due to TB also was a different. But we did bronchoalveolar lavage from the but no fungal isolates were done and no tubercular evidence was also obtained. But he was also put on ATT from physician point of view, and also injection dexa was also given.
So when you put them on antifungals,
yes,
did
also antifungals.
So
plus
did the brain lesions and the lung lesions improve?
Yes, they also improved, but simultaneously he was also on ATT, so we don't know actually.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Next paper would be changes in high altitude retinopathy patterns in COVID recovered persons. Has not come, absent. So we move to the next paper, that short-term outcomes of combined buccal and scleral imbrication for complex RDs. Presenting author would be Dr. Subhadra Jalali.
Thank you. So I'm going to report on the short-term treatment outcomes of a novel surgical technique I've been using for the last 2 years of combined buccal with modified scleral imbrication for ROP and other childhood onset complex retinal detachments. This is a retrospective analysis of my first 24 eyes in children. I have a separate series on adults. And this was basically a modified scleral imbrication combined with encircling band with or without a buckle. And the outcome measure was the anatomical success of this procedure. So you know, we many times get these weird types of detachments where you're totally lost. There's exudative component, tractional component. It's very close to the lens. And I've been operating these cases for the last 30 years, struggling with lensectomy, oil, multiple EUAs, glaucoma, band keratopathy. Not really very happy with that. And so I went back to the history of scleral imbrication and was surprised to know that this was one of the commonest procedures and a very successful procedures done for rheumatogenous retinal detachments in Oregon School. More recent literature mostly talks about use of this procedure in myopic eyes from Japan. But there's not been much literature on ROP surgeries, although when I discussed with Dr. Gopal and Mahesh, they said that they've done few cases, but we don't have the data or the videos of that. And so I just want to share my video. Can we have the sound, please? Precision is given at the site where the maximum traction is. Usually this would be the equator, but it can be anterior posterior to it. And then I give two vertical incisions on the sides. Create two flaps up and down. So I think any surgeon who's doing buccals, who's done implants, they can, you know, very well perform this. I'm showing this
and
to show it can be done by anybody.
Suture these with non-absorbable 5-0 ethibond or 5-0 Dacron sutures and make it very tight.
So as you saw that I've just modified the technique from a spindle-shaped opening to a square opening, which I think is taking care of more things because under the muscle we are not dissecting. So if the lesion is under the muscle, then these square openings would probably, you know, help on either side of the muscle also. And it's easier to make the pockets when it is square rather than if it is spindle shaped. And most of the studies talk about, you know, the imbrication without the buccal. But the cases that I was doing had so much of pathology that I was not, you know, very confident that just the imbrication
once
would take
tightened,
care.
Once it is tightened, then you can put on the buccal or you can, you know, drain it. And also, I always do a paracentesis in these eyes to make it soft so that the buccal height and the imbrication can be achieved to the extent that we want.
So this imbrication just becomes an additional step in the treatment of a buccal case. And these are eyes where normally we would not think of doing a buccal. So these are eyes where
this
we normally take
vitrectomy. This can be done in one or more quadrants. The minimum quadrants I have done is 2 quadrants and the maximum I have done is all 4 quadrants. In the initial phase, I used to remove the scleral flaps, but lately I have been putting it back and then suturing it. The contentious points could be whether the buccal will intrude or the sutures will intrude or whether there will be any ischemic necrosis. So far has not happened.
So the results are that in the last 2 years, we did 24 eyes. All these patients have very long-term follow-up with us. They have been in our database, and then in between, they developed some complication for which this Surgery was done. The youngest patient was 3 months and the oldest is 14 years in this series. The commonest etiology was ROP-related problems where they developed a rheumatogenous detachment in addition to the retinal fold and traction they had. And there were 7 eyes which were FEVR-related where the progressive tractional and exudative detachment was happening, and there was one with a Regardi in a persistent fetal vasculature. All these patients did not have any obvious break, or there was only suspicious breaks, and that's why they were not suitable for a buckling surgery. The follow-up has been 6 weeks to 2 years, and the good point is that a single surgery, a single anesthesia, no repeated anesthesia, it could help at least 79% of the cases. And one additional case, I did silicone oil surgery where the surgery did not work, so you still have the option of doing the second surgery. There were no major complications, mild rise of IOP, which may require medication. Again, the visual acuity outcomes in these children were extremely gratifying, with most of them recording a very good vision. So this is just the, I think the pictures speak for themselves, how a single procedure is taking care of the problem. This was a child who had operated for ROP stage 4B when he was 11 months, and then comes at 4 years, not playing for last 1 week. After 2 years, he's ready to go to school with 2400 vision. My colleague asked me that, will these folds flatten? I was not convinced. I said, no, they won't flatten. How will they flatten? But I was presently surprised that a single procedure without vitrectomy, everything has gone. And I think it's like, you know, if you have a paper boat and you try to squeeze it, the bottom will become flat. And that's what has happened. And again, these are very weird. You just think if you go inside and do vitrectomy, you'll be just lost with that thin retina creating multiple breaks. Single procedure, 20/50 and 8 vision with telescope. But I think the retinal surgeon's work doesn't finish with reattaching the retina. These are the OCT and B-scan pictures. What it required is care beyond the surgery. This particular patient was written as going to blind school by the referring ophthalmologist after the surgery. They came crying back to us, and when we did the low vision aid assessment, he has 20/50 and 8, and this is the certificate we gave that he is completely fit to join the Navodaya Vidyalaya, and he's now studying, and we are doing teleconsult with the principal every 6 months to convince them that this child is really brilliant and going to do. So thank you everyone. I share some old wine in a new bottle, and I hope all of you will get intoxicated.
Wonderful job done, but what was the choice of your buckle, and keeping in view the size of the eyeball of anterior ischemic changes, such a large buckle, why did you not choose a 4 millimeter buckle rather than a 2.76 tile?
Yeah, so
the choice
of buckles, depending on the eye size and the lesion size, could be a 240 band or a 42 band or a 276 or a 287. So it always depended on how much was the area of the lesion and what was the size of the eyeball. So different types of buckles and bands were used in different cases.
No, none of them had anterior ischemic changes with large buckle and small size eyes.
I don't expect, because we are not disturbing the muscle. See, the vessels going to the muscle and the anterior sclera. We are not disturbing that. It's just like doing a normal buckle. We do 360 degree buckle. So I don't think so. I was initially a little skeptical. Most of the cases require only 2 quadrants, because most of the pathology is temporal. Sometimes it's nasal. But we had patients like that 11-year-old boy who was a aphakic. We couldn't make out where is the pathology. So we were going in blind. So I did all 4 quadrants and he was fine. And I'm not expecting ischemia, because we are not disturbing the muscle and the anterociliary circulation of the eye.
Great.
I must congratulate you for what you have done. It actually took us back about 30 years when we were also doing implants to begin with.
Yes.
The difference was you sutured it first and then you put the implant on top.
Yes, that makes all the difference, because those we used to get, intrusions or necrosis. So that's where this technique is very good. That you are putting the buckle on a bed of sclera, so you won't get intrusion.
One of the bigger things that doesn't occur is actually the scleral rupture underneath the buckle area in case of these things.
Yeah, and we are not doing diathermy. Those cases we used to do diathermy, which is what used to also add to the necrosis. So I'm fortunate. I did a lot of implants during my fellowship, so this was easier. But anybody who's doing buckles can do this.
I just had one last question. How often did you get thinner scleras in younger children?
So this picture that I showed you, this is a 3-month-old baby. So if it's very thin, then the technique described is that you don't need to make a flap. You can still do the imbrication, but you'll have to do a good paracentesis 2-3 times. Small babies, we don't give mannitol to make it soft. But people have described imbrication in high myopes without making the flaps.
Thank you. Thank you.
Can I ask a question? A very nice presentation. I just had a question on
would you use this for all patients, or is there some particular selection criteria where you would use this technique on its own with an encerclage or with a buckle?
So I haven't done any cases without a additional buckle or encerclage because I'm not like really convinced, because I don't want to go back and do a second surgery. So I want to do once for all. But this case selection is where there's a combined detachment, generally, like it's exudative and tractional with a fold, and I don't know what is happening to that eye. Or there's a regma, and we don't know where that regma is. You know, so those type of cases, and you saw thin retina. So most of these are like, you know, complicated chronic cases, but one case and few cases are in acute phase also. And I've been surprised that, you know, some of these acute phases actually have a reg RD in ROP. Initially, we always used to think it's tractional and exudative. But the more we look, then we can see that, yes, there's a regma, and that's why they don't do very well with vitrectomy. So they do extremely well with this procedure. So I'm still learning.
You're going to be removing that buckle?
I have not done it so far. Even in the normal buckle eyes, I am not convinced that we should remove all of them. I don't. Initially, okay. I used to because the literature said so.
Yes.
But literature didn't say why. It said it may intrude or it may cause myopia. And then many of my patients didn't come for follow-up. And it was not removed. And they're doing fine. So I just do it on individual basis, not as a routine.
Thank you so much.
Next paper would be assessment of macular vessel density and retinal layer matrix in COVID-19 patients. It's not a... Okay, genetic power next is absent. No, before that we have to see. Is he present or no? Not present. So absent. Because we have to write here that he's present.
He's there.
Then why is he not coming? But I named the paper. Assessment of macular vessel density and retinal layer matrix in COVID-19 patients. Dr. Semendra.
So good evening, everyone. My paper will be on genetic power predictive, preventive, and therapeutic strategies for retinal dystrophies. You have gone a couple of steps ahead compared to our previous work. As we all know, inherited retinal dystrophies are progressive. So major cause of untreatable blindness in both is characterized by retinal degeneration, including retinal pigment epithelium and the photoreceptors. So this is the typical conversation which happens in a retinal dystrophy clinic. We diagnose you have a retinal dystrophy. Patient asks, how do we cure this? Sorry, no cure. So can you do something to treat? So nothing to treat. You can use low vision aids, consult rehabilitation services. So will this condition pass on to the next generation? So you can go for the genetic testing. So then patient comes with a series of questions like, does my vision going to deteriorate? Will I go blind? So what do I can do to prevent further vision loss? Can I expect something for the cure in the future? So with the aim of addressing these questions in the Indian context, so as clinical models of dystrophies need to be studied in India and needs to be comprehensively analyzed along with the disease phenotype, so we began an observational study approved by Institutional Review Board. Informed consent were taken. A total of 100 patients in the age group 5 to 65 years were studied, 61 males and 39 females. All patients underwent comprehensive eye examination, including imaging. So electrophysiological tests were done where required with strict adherence to ISCV protocols. So coming to the genetic testing, this time we used next generation targeted sequencing, including 240 retina specific genes to bring down the cost. So and the variant calling in the gene of interest was looked into. So we found out many mutations in almost all forms of retinal dystrophies, ABCA4 being the common one. So coming back to my title, how this data is going to be predictive, preventive and therapeutic. So let me explain the same with the case example. So this was a 43-year-old female who presented with low vision, shared atrophic macular changes. So we ended up discovering a total new gene, which is called SERPINF1, which is never reported in the literature. So incidentally, father and the two asymptomatic children were also carrying the same mutation. When he saw the father, he had atrophic macular changes. He had some ambulatory vision. He was not blind. So children who were asymptomatic, fundus looked clinically normal. Retinal layers were quite intact. However, autofluorescence did show some changes in the macula. So full-field ERG was near normal. The pattern ERG left eye had a reduced P50 amplitude. However, multifocal ERG showed reduced central responses in both eyes. So here we have a three-generation OCT and autofluorescence. So next time any of you, if you come across RPNF gene mutation, you know like what's the prognosis going to be, and there could be some strategies which can be adopted to prevent this progression. I'll come to that later. So this was one more patient, 14-year-old female, had atrophic foveal changes. And this patient had a compound heterozygous mutation in ABCA4, and mother was found to be homozygous for one of this mutation. So, but mother was totally asymptomatic. The fundus looked clinically normal. However, autofluorescence did show some early bullseye maculopathic iliac lesion. And our ellipsoid zone in the foveola was quite intact. So that's the reason for she being asymptomatic. So we have like 14 years old daughter and a 40 year old mother, same gene, same family, but the younger patient has got more aggressive disease. The reason being, though the gene is same, the kind of mutation is different. So next time if I come across a similar scenario, I know like which patient is going to do well and which patient is going to have more atrophic features. So most of this macular dystrophy, especially the ABCA4 associated, they have a common final pathway of excessive metabolic overload, which lysozymes fail to clear, resulting in apoptosis of RP and photoreceptor. This can, to an extent, can be avoided by using dark glasses to bring down the visual psychostimulation. And also we should avoid vitamin A and A-rate nutrient supplementations. Coming to the therapeutic aspect of it, we know like from genes to gene therapy, we have come a long way, powered by the genetics. So what is gene therapy? Gene therapy is basically correcting a defective gene. It can be done in multiple ways by trading a healthy gene for an abnormal gene or changing the regulatory genes. I won't go into the details of it. So we have demonstrated efficacy of adenovirus associated transduction in retinal layers in our previous papers. So the problem is some of the genes, ABCA4, which is quite common in here. So these genes are very large, which can't be fit into a single virion. So we come up with a dual vector strategy where we split the gene into two products. These were loaded into the separate virions and they were co-infected together where they reach the target cells and where they are expected to function normally. So this is our dedicated clinical grade vector production facility. So these are our early results. This is a control mouse where phosphate buffer solution was injected. And we have one mouse we injected intact vector, in another we injected dual vector. If you see the intact and the dual vector, the uptake which is seen in the blue color, it is there comparable. That means our dual vectors are working. So there are many challenges when it comes to manufacturing the clinical grade vector. So that is the reason like the approved gene therapy products like Luxturna and Zolgensma, they are cost in crores, which I don't think even the 0.1% of Indian patients can afford. So I always like to conclude the studies under these three headings. What we knew was genetic testing can help in accurate diagnosis and family planning. So gene therapy is efficacious for retinal dystrophy. There are many trials going on. What this study adds is genetics of Indian patients are diverse and can be used as a predictive biomarkers. Indigenously developed AAV vectors successfully expressed in genes in animal retina and novel dual vector strategy for large genes. So of course our future plan is to generate Indian genetic database for almost all retinal phenotypes so that we know the prognosis. So and also to produce clinical grade vector production for human trials. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Purnachandra, for a very interesting presentation. A little bit difficult I found to understand is how this, exactly this patient population, you extrapolated it to your upcoming therapeutic strategies.
No, I'm not extrapolating this particular population. When it comes to therapeutic, it still remains the individual patient. It has to be according to the base pair mutation, which is this thing. When it comes to extrapolating, it's the genetic diagnosis as a whole. For example, where I showed compound heterozygous patients, if we have some 100 patients with similar mutation, then we can tell. So basically, that's our future plan, to generate that such data for all forms of dystrophies, not from the therapeutic point of view. That has to be individual patient-based. Yeah.
Thank you.
Next, we go to Dr. Samendra.
Good afternoon, everyone, and I thank AIOC for giving me this opportunity. My topic of free paper is assessment of macular vessel density and retinal layer matrix in COVID-19 patients post-recovery. I have no financial disclosures. The COVID-19 disease caused by SARS-CoV-2 is a highly pathogenic human coronavirus. With approximately 43.1 million cases, India is only second to United States. Ocular manifestations are yet to be fully understood. Conjunctivitis has been reported frequently. However, non-specific retinal signs such as microhemorrhages, flame-shaped hemorrhages, and RNFL infarcts have been reported during active phase of the disease. We undertook a study where we wanted to study the macular retinal vessel density, subfoveal choroidal thickness, and retinal layer matrix by OCT angiography, spectral domain OCT, and enhanced depth imaging OCT in COVID-19 recovered patients. And this was compared with the parameters in healthy controls. This is the study was also to assess the correlation between octa parameters and the severity and duration of COVID-19. COVID-19 disease. The design was a case control study conducted at a tertiary multi-speciality referral institute in central India. There were 360 eyes from 180 subjects from two groups. Group 1 consisted of 120 eyes from 60 subjects, and group 2 had 240 eyes from 120 healthy subjects with no history of COVID-19 disease. The inclusion criteria was history of positive RT-PCR, documented report of COVID-19 pneumonia, mild, moderate or severe disease, and patients who have fully recovered from COVID-19 and tested negative by RT-PCR on two separate visits. Exclusion criteria was basically we excluded cases who had any form of retinal lesion which would result in a permanent change to retinal anatomy. And at the same time, systemic diseases like diabetes, hypertension, smoking, or a poor quality scan were excluded. Measurements were carried out for macular vessel density and foveal avascular zone area using 3x3 mm screening protocol. And this was done for superficial and deep capillary plexus. Vessel density was computed in all the sectors and full vessel density. The assessment of retinal metrics used 7x7 mm of retina protocol and assessed central subfield thickness, average GCL-IPL thickness, RNFL thickness, inner nuclear layer, outer nuclear layer, and outer plexiform layer. Assessment of subfoveal choroidal thickness used a horizontal raster scan centered on the fovea. The results showed that there was reduction in the foveal avascular zone in the controls as compared in the cases as compared to controls, and this was significant. The subfoveal choroidal thickness was also was increased compared to controls, and this was significant. Again, there was reduction in average GCL-IPL, outer plexiform layer, and outer nuclear layer thickness, and these values were significant. The correlation of OCT angio parameters was performed with the severity of disease, and it correlated for vessel density in the superficial capillary plexus and also in the deep capillary plexus. Association of OCT angio parameters with history of corticosteroid therapy was also performed as a subgroup analysis, and out of these cases, 10 patients were given high dose corticosteroids, and it was found that the deep capillary plexus vessel density was found to be reduced in patients where steroids were given. There was also a correlation which was found between OCT angio, OCT angiography parameters with the duration of disease. So these are the OCT angio parameters. The foveal avascular zone area, both superficial and deep, and retinal layer metrics, they showed significant reduction, while there was a significant increase in subfoveal choroidal thickness in COVID-19 patients. Sectoral vessel density were reduced among group 1 or cases with disease severity. Correlation was found among sectoral vessel density, FAS, and retinal layer metrics with the duration of disease. In subgroup analysis, corticosteroids treatment resulted in significant reduction in vessel density. OCTA showed alteration in retinal microvasculature and retinal metrics in COVID-19 patients. FAS and subfoveal choroidal thickness were also altered post-COVID despite recovery, and corticosteroids appeared to alter retinal microvasculature. However, longitudinal studies on larger cohorts will be required with longer follow-up for better predictability and establish definitive correlation. In conclusion, OCTA showed alteration in retinal microvasculature and retinal metrics in COVID-19 patients that persisted post-recovery. OCTA detected these retinal microvascular alterations in the absence of any clinical manifestation of disease, and OCTA may serve as a potential imaging biomarker or a precursor of systemic or neurologic microvascular dysfunction. These are my references. Thank you.
So conclusion is its cause is alteration or it causes ischemia?
Sir, ischemia could be the underlying factor that brings about this alteration that we have measured using OCTA.
Thank you for a nice paper. I just had a query on your comment on corticosteroids, and you say that it alters the retinal vasculature. Is it a transient alteration or is it a permanent alteration? Because corticosteroids are given to patients patients for varying indications. Yes.
Ma'am, we had assessed patients who received high-dose corticosteroids, especially pulse therapy, and there were 10 of those patients, and we found that the SFCT was increased, however, the FAS area had reduced. So, we assessed this only at the end of 3 months post-COVID. Probably, if we follow up these patients for next 1 year, maybe we'll see whether it persists or it reverts back.
Would you be equating this to steroid-induced CSCR, the increase in SFCT?
Increase in SFCT could be attributed, ma'am, to a compensatory increased blood flow, which is basically due to the choriocapillaris ischemia. So we are not really sure as to why that happened. This was just an observation.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
A very good afternoon, everyone. My study is on blister-like retinopathy of prematurity, an atypical and severe form of ROP. As this study has been already been presented in last year AIOS and was awarded as best poster, so I request the judges note to judge this presentation. As we all know, that retinopathy of prematurity is a potentially blinding vasoproliferative disease affecting retina of premature infants. Classically, the disease has been described as passing through 5 stages, starting from appearance of demarcation line to formation of ridge, extraretinal fibrovascular proliferation, subtotal and total retinal detachment. Additionally, a rapidly progressive form of disease characterized by multiple arteriovenous shunts, flat neovascularization and loops has been described as aggressive posterior ROP. The aim of this study was to study the demographic profile, clinical presentation and treatment outcomes of an atypical and severe form of ROP in zone 1, which we described as blister-like ROP. Retrospective review of clinical records of preterm infants presenting with atypical posterior configurations in zone 1 were studied. Demographic details, morphology of presentation and intervention done in the form of laser photocoagulation, intravitreal anti-VEGF therapy or surgery, either a lensectomy vitrectomy or a lens-sparing vitrectomy were studied. And outcomes in the form of either progression to stage 5 ROP or regression of disease with delineation of vascular arcades were analyzed. Coming to results, 22 eyes of 11 infants were studied. The mean gestational age was 29 weeks, mean birth weight 1335 grams, and mean age at presentation was 38 weeks. All infants were outborn. All infants gave history of oxygen supplementation. History of sepsis was present in three patients, while two received blood transfusion. This table describes the morphology, disease morphology at presentation. In all the eyes, there was arrest of retinal vasculature in zone 1. There was fibrovascular proliferation at or around the optic disc. Retcam FFA performed in 5 patients showed arrest of retinal vasculature and leakage from FVP at disc. We observed 3 different patterns of this atypical presentation. In pattern 1, there was arrest of retinal vasculature and a fibrovascular proliferation could be appreciated arising along a persistent fetal vasculature stalk that resulted in peripapillary TRD and retcam FFA showed vascular leakage from this FVP. In second pattern, there was a spongy exudative detachment of peripapillary retina. There was no PFV stalk, however, the retcam FFA showed arrest of retinal vasculature and leakage within this spongy mass. The eyes with pattern 3 actually presented as early zone 1 AP-ROP with or without pre-existing nasal FVP. Upon follow-up, these eyes developed exudative detachment around the disc and subsequently there was contraction of hyoid and appearance similar to pattern 1. So this table summarizes the interventions done and outcomes. 10 of the 22 eyes showed regression of disease. Out of these 10 eyes, 7 received multimodal or trimodal therapy comprising all 3, that is laser photocoagulation, intravitreal anti-VEGF and surgery in form of lensectomy vitrectomy or lens sparing vitrectomy. Let us look at this representative case of a baby born at 32 weeks period of gestation in 1600 grams. At presentation, we can see exudative detachment in peripapillary region. There is a rest of retinal vasculature all around, and multiple retinal and pre-retinal hemorrhages can be appreciated. Laser photocoagulation was done in both the eyes on the day of presentation, and this was followed by both-eye intravitreal anti-VEGF injection and early lens-sparing vitrectomy. Following treatment, we can see the resolution of this peripapillary exudation and opening up of the vascular arcades. The possible pathophysiological mechanisms for such atypical presentation include severe retinal ischemia due to vaso-obliteration and capillary dropout in posterior zone 1. Breakdown of outer blood retinal barrier might have resulted in the exudative detachment, the kind seen in pattern 2. There seems to be contribution of delayed regression of persistent fetal vasculature and posterior hyoid contracture to the kind of peripapillary fibrovascular proliferation and TID we are seeing. To conclude, this study describes an atypical morphology of ROP in preterm infants that has not been included in ICROP classification till yet. The proliferation arises in optic disc region, and there is rapid progression to stage 5 ROP with treatment or if we treat with laser photocoagulation alone. Oxygen supplementation, sepsis, and blood transfusion are likely to play a role in development of morphology, of this morphology. The associated risk factors and any genetic association for such atypical presentation needs to be studied further. Combination therapy comprising multimodal or trimodal treatment comprising all three, that is laser photocoagulation, intravitreal anti-VEGF, and early surgery are likely to provide the best chance of successful outcome. Thank you.
Wonderful. So you suggest a stage 6 disease.
So currently, because this fits in, doesn't fit into either of this, so there seems to be, like, there may be a role of abnormal vitreous, or this may be a combination thing of persistent fetal stock. So we have not done genetic testing or so. The next step would be genetic testing and close observation.
Or we would say plus disease 2. Okay, it's a very interesting thing. And kindly let me know that all of your cases, was there any association of any other than disease? This is sepsis, blood transfusion, this oxygen therapy. It goes on for years. Was there any other association which predisposed them to this blister retinopathy, like say IVF, consensual marriage, or any other some predictive where we would suggest that these would be the predictive ones to such an ischemia?
So we took detailed demographic history and also about the risk factors.
Yeah.
We could find only these three the risk factors.
No, they are in common all over. But
yeah.
This much of ischemia, this much of dystrophy, was there any other risk factor which is not commonly seen in your study? There may be nothing.
So probably they were very preterm, like less than 32 weeks or so. And okay. We also saw a pattern, like in pattern 3. The baby came to us with zone 1 APROP. And in follow-up, in 2-3 days, he developed exudation and subsequently fibrovascular proliferation at disc. It may be there that these all three these patterns could be sequential, and we may be picking up because the babies are presenting at different time intervals. But this is very atypical of current ROP, that classification or phenotype has been described in literature.
Good. So our next speaker would be Aurolab drainage devices in vitreous for refractory glaucoma.
Good evening, everyone. The topic of my paper is outcomes of Aurolab aqueous drainage implant placement in vitreous cavity in refractory glaucoma. I'm Dr. Akriti Gundaria, and my co-author and guide is Dr. Syed Mohideen Abdul Qadir. This study was conducted in Arvind Eye Hospital, Tirunelveli, and RD or Aurolab aqueous drainage implant is developed by Aurolab, a manufacturing division of Arvind Eye Care System. So glaucoma drainage devices have been used for refractory glaucomas in which previous trabeculectomy surgery is likely to have a high chance of failure. And refractory glaucoma is defined as those who have previously failed conventional medical laser and surgical treatment or a combination of the above. Anterior chamber placement of tube is the convention, but it is extremely difficult in shallow or distorted anterior chamber with extensive peripheral anterior synecae and pre-existing corneal diseases and corneal endothelial damage, and also when there is vitreous prolapse in the anterior chamber. So past planar placement of a GDD tube is an option in these cases. So the other rationale for posterior segment placement of a GDD is when additional posterior segment procedures are required, like lens fragment removal, foreign body removal, retinal detachment surgery, vitrectomy for long-standing vitreous hemorrhage, silicone oil removal, endolaser for neovascular glaucoma or other pathologies leading to neovascular glaucoma, and epiretinal membrane peeling. But it also comes with its complications and disadvantages. That is, the placement of the tube itself can lead to vitreous hemorrhage or retinal detachment, choroidal detachment, endophthalmitis. And if a complete PPV is not done, that can lead to tube block and failure. So this is the Aurolab aqueous drainage implant. It is a non-valved glaucoma drainage device, and it is based on the principle of the Bearwald implant 350. It is a very low-cost alternative to the Bearwald implant. It is around $50, that is around 3,000 to 4,000 rupees, where the conventional Amed glaucoma valve is in the range of $350. It has a plate with four fenestrations. These fenestrations allow for fibrovascular proliferation and formation of the bleb, and also a tube. So this is one of our representative cases in which we had combined the RD implantation with an SFIOL and a pars plana vitrectomy. Since an SFIOL was also planned, a 360 degree peritomy was done, where when you plan a RD implant alone, a 120 degree peritomy in the inferior nasal quadrant is enough. Video, can it be played again?
Can anybody help her?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Okay. So, here after the 4 mm is measured behind the limbus if it's a phakic patient, and 3.5 if it's pseudophakic, and 3 mm if aphakic. And a scleral tunnel is made basically for the placement of the RD tube. Making of the scleral tunnel is a very crucial step. We should avoid any perforation and look for it, any thinning of the sclera while making it. Sorry. Sorry again. So once the scleral tunnel is made, we also secure the inferior rectus and the medial rectus muscles, because these the RD tube is planned to be placed under these muscles. These are the pockets that is made for the SFIOL subsequently. Once the RD tube is placed under the inferior rectus and medial rectus muscle, it is secured with nylon sutures with the fenestrations provided for suturing. Then a pars plana vitrectomy is done, and this vitrectomy needs to be complete in order to avoid tube blockage. In this case, the lens was also dislocated, so a pars plana lensectomy was also combined. The RD tube is then passed through the tunnel that is made, and it is cut. Also, a vicryl suture is tied at the tube in order to prevent immediate post-op hypotony. This tube is then placed through an opening made in the pars plana. And a thorough vitrectomy is again confirmed and done. So our study is a retrospective study. Its duration was 3 years, from January 2017 to 2020, and 54 eyes of 53 patients were included. In the, their demographic details, ocular history, and indications for surgery were documented, and all their primary diagnoses were divided into four categories: primary open angle, primary angle closure, secondary open angle, and secondary angle closure glaucoma. Their baseline IOP and number of AGM were documented, and at 1 month, the IOP and the 6 month IOP and number of AGM were documented. Our results showed that the mean age of the participants was 49 years, and maximum patients were of the secondary angle closure glaucoma type. Most of the patients were pseudophakic prior to surgery, and other patients were phakic, either underwent a combined phaco with RD implantation or underwent a pars plana lensectomy with RD implantation. And previous surgical procedures, maximum of the cases had previous cataract and vitrectomy done, while around 18% of the patients had cataract alone, only 13% had cataract and TRAB done previously, and 6% had TRAB alone. There were 26% eyes that were had not undergone any previous surgical procedure. And 20 eyes had undergone only the RD implantation, while 34 eyes underwent additional posterior segment procedure along with the RD surgery. And the IOP and the number of AGM showed a significant decrease at the first and 6 months. And a multivariate and univariate analysis showed that the demographic details and additional procedures did not affect the postoperative IOP. But open angle glaucomas had a favorable outcome in reduction of postoperative anti-glaucoma medications. There were 19 eyes, or 35%, had some post-op complications, most all of which were treated except for 2 eyes that underwent ictus bulbi. So this study shows that pars plana placement of the tube showed a significant decrease in IOP and number of AGM, and open angle glaucoma was associated with better reduction of AGM post surgery. So RD placement can be safely combined with additional retinal procedures without affecting the surgical outcome. The small sample size and short-term follow-up are our main limitations. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you. Do you have any questions?
Any other
Have you had any occasion to do these when there was an encircling band or a buckle in place, and how did you manage it in that?
Yes, ma'am. We did have around 3 cases which did have a scleral buckle with silicon oil in situ, and the silicon oil was the reason for the secondary glaucoma. So in that case, the tube was dismantled from the plate, and the tube was directly attached to the capsule, that fibrous capsule already around the scleral buckle, and that also showed good outcomes.
And how did you manage the oil bit?
The oil was removed, oil was removed.
You think that just giving one suture in the tube, you can control the hypotony?
Sir, we did have cases of postoperative hypotony, but the vicryl suture dissolves slowly over a period of 2 weeks. That allows the bleb to form. And once the fibrous capsule is formed, there is a lesser chance of hypotony. That is the purpose of the suture. And also, sometimes when cases have extremely high IOP, we did make fenestrations in the tube to allow some of the aqueous to egress so that there wouldn't be very high IOP also post-op. So
how did the conjunctiva behave in the follow-up? Sometimes the conjunctiva actually becomes very thin.
Yes, sir. Since the RD plate was very posterior, so the conjunctiva over the RD we could not assess as well as it can be assessed in, say, an anterior placement of the tube or in a TRAB surgery. But no such thinning specifically was noted, sir.
Thank you.
Thank
nice
you, sir.
Presentation.
Thank you.
Dr. Kumar.
Good evening to all the panelists and the audience over here. So I'm here to present my free paper on correlation between ultra-wide field fluorescein angiography and OCT angiography in retinal vein occlusion post-loading doses of anti-VEGF in REN study. So we, as we all know, retinal vein occlusion is the second most common vascular pathology after diabetic retinopathy, and the long-term sequelae of this retinal vein occlusion is retinal neovascularization, which arises because of the extensive peripheral retinal ischemia. And therefore, the adequate measurement of the non-perfusion area is critical in the management of retinal vein occlusion. So there's an index called ischemic index, which is basically the ratio of the non-perfused retina to the total visible area, which can be calculated on the ultra-wide field fluorescein angiography. And with the advent of OCT angiography, we can quantitatively as well as qualitatively assess the microvasculature and retinal vein occlusion. And there has been one paper by Glasser Bernard et al. Who compared the non-perfusion area on ultra-wide field fluorescein angiography with the wide field octa. So the lacunae knowledge has been that there's a need for a non-invasive, safe, and easy to manipulate measurements to evaluate the ischemic status of retina in the retinal vein occlusion. And this non-invasive measurement can be used as a predictive factor for necessary fluorescein angiography. However, there have been no studies on the relationship between the ordinary octa and the ultraviolet field fluorescein angiography in retinal vein occlusion from this part of the world. So the aim of our study was to find out the correlation between the non-perfusion area on ultraviolet field fluorescein angiography and the non-flow area of octa, and thereby predict ischemic status of peripheral retina in patients undergoing staged combination therapy for retinal vein occlusion-related macular edema using the RENS protocol. So this was a cross-sectional interventional single-center case series, and the main inclusion criteria were only the branch retinal vein occlusion patients, and the study period was between June 2022 to August 2021, and the ultraviolet field fluorescein angiography and OCT angiography was done at 3 months, and we had excluded the macular venous occlusions and the CRVO. And briefly looking at the flow chart of the RINS protocol, which stands for ranibizumab injection and steroid implant Ozodex with laser photocoagulation. So any patient with retinal vein occlusion with macular edema was first treated with 3 loading doses of anti-VEGF. And at 3 months, if there was a recurrence of macular edema, then a wide field fluorescein angiography was performed. And if there was a retinal ischemia on fluorescein angiography, then the patient would be undergoing laser with anti-VEGF injection. However, if there was no retinal ischemia, then Ozodex implant was injected. So coming on to the ultraviolet field fluorescein angiography parameter, we calculated the ischemic index, which was basically, we took the arteriovenous phase of the ultraviolet field fluorescein angiography, and the grader here mapped the entire image area, which in this case was 9 cm². And then the next thing was the mapping of the non-perfusion area on ultraviolet field fluorescein angiography. And in this case, it was 2.7 cm², and thereby we get an ischemic index of 0.3 in this case. And the parameters of octa which were taken into consideration were the vessel density of the superficial and the deep and false slab, the foveal avascular zone area, and the non-flow area. So if we look at this is the superficial vessel density, the superficial capillary plexus slab, and we can see the non-perfusion area. And from the software, we could get the superficial vessel density. And similarly, the deep vessel density of all the quadrants were taken from the from the grid map. And the foveal avascular zone was calculated in the arteriovenous phase of the superficial capillary plexus. And the non-flow area, which we see here, was manually graded by the manually mapped by the grader. So here we click on all these non-flow areas, and then the software would sum up them together to give the total non-flow area on the octa. So basically, we are comparing the peripheral non-perfusion with the non-flow area on the octa of the central retina in cases of RVO, and this was done using the Spearman correlation test to examine the linear correlation between the octa parameters and the non-perfusion area and the ISI on the ultraviolet field fluorescein angiography. Coming on to the results, there were 34 eyes which qualified for data analysis. 52% patients were female. 20 eyes were with ST-BRVO. 14 eyes were with infrotemporal BRVO. The mean non-perfusion area on ultraviolet field fluorescein angiography was 2.52 with an ischemic index of 0.34. And the non-flow area was 2.92 with a foveal avascular zone area of 0.25. And we can see that the superficial capillary, the temporal vessel density in the both the superficial as the deep capillary plexus was less compared to other quadrants. And looking at the Spearman correlation test, we can see that the non-flow area correlated positively with the non-perfusion area for ultraviolet field fluorescein angiography as well as with the ischemic index. However, the temporal superficial capillary plexus as well as the deep capillary plexus vessel density was negatively correlated. So taking an example, so this case had a rebound macular edema at third month, and we can see that there was a non-flow area on octa, and on ultraviolet field fluorescein angiography, there was significant amount of peripheral ischemia with leakage. So the patient was subjected to laser with repeat anti-VEGF injection. So to conclude, positive strong correlation was found between the non-perfusion area and the ischemic index with the non-flow area of octa. Thank you.
Thank you for a a very interesting presentation. Now, looking at your results, do you think you would like to do this even before the treatment to decide? You took this later, right? Is it because of the hemorrhages that you're expecting to block?
Yes, mainly because of the hemorrhages, because at that stage, the octa might not be showing the exact amount of capillary dropouts or the non-flow areas. So that is why we waited for 3 months. So once with the loading phases of the injection and everything, once the washout had happened. So, but yes, we can try in the initial phases, say after first dose of injection, with some amount of clearing which happens mostly in most of the RVO cases.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Dr. Roy is in absent. Sure. So we come to end of first half of the session. We have second half of the session also, and Madam will introduce the second half of the session. Go ahead.
Just give me a minute, I'll finish scoring. I think after this we'd be judging the semi-finals of the vitreoretinal diseases section. So we also have two presenters who are the winners of session one and session two. What about session three? Because this is session four. Then? Is there anyone from session three who's come?